started leaving back and forth. But that's okay.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to Simply Midnight Methodist Church. So glad you can join us for worship today. I'm Josh, the pastor here, and I hope that over this next hour or so we're together, that you will feel welcomed in our midst, hope you feel connected, and most importantly, I hope you can encounter the living and risen Lord Jesus. And so this morning, I want to invite us to hear a call to worship from Psalm 93. The psalmist says, "The Lord reigns. He is robed in majesty. The Lord is robed in majesty and is armed with strength. The world is firmly established. It cannot be moved." You know, as you read those verses, it's part of what it's pointing to is not only God's glory, but his sovereignty. That God is Lord over all. That no matter how much our world sometimes seems like it's just spiraling out of control, God is still on the throne. God is still in control. And God will ultimately move history to his end, a new creation. And that's the promise we have, that God's going to come one day, Jesus will return and make all things right and all things new. So no matter what this week has looked like for you, no matter what the news is saying, the good news is Jesus has died, Jesus has risen, and Jesus is coming again.
Amen.
And so today as we begin, I invite you to turn your attention to Jesus with me. I open with a word of prayer. Lord Jesus, we thank you that in the midst of a world that many times just looks like it's out of control, you, Lord, are still in control. And so, God, in the midst of the brokenness of this world, in the midst of the questions of this life, we choose to place our trust in you. We choose to find ourselves in your story rather than trying to make it up on our own. And we choose, God, to trust in your sovereignty and your power. So today, God, as we pray, as we sing your praises, as we read the scriptures, we ask that your Holy Spirit would illuminate them to our hearts. May you be glorified and our lives be transformed by your grace. We pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Well, today as we begin, I'm going to invite you to stand and join us. We're going to begin with some singing and invite you to join us with your hearts and your voices.
Joy of the Lord.
invite any children who are with us to come forward, and we are going to bless, if you have a backpack with you, you're going to bring your backpack up for the blessing of backpacks. If you don't, you still may come forward, you don't have to have one. Our children come to a children's message, and as they do, just invite the congregation to turn to someone, just greet them, welcome them this morning, introduce yourself, if maybe you don't know them. Jesus, when he was a boy, Jesus would go to the temple. He was teaching even as a child. And it says in Luke 2:22, and Jesus grew in wisdom and stature and in favor with God and men. That as Jesus was a boy, he was growing and God was doing stuff in him. He grew in wisdom and in stature. And that as he grew, God gave him favor with men and even with himself. And so, you know, every year when you go to school, it's an opportunity to grow. How do you think you grow at school? Anyways, you grow? You grow by eating vegetables. That's exactly right. Although Mr. Yosh might disagree. He might want to go with the sugar, the Cinnabons. How else do you grow every year when you go to school? You grow more stuff. That's right. Anything else? Great, good answers. You're doing your faith with Jesus. Very good. It's like your dad would have taught you something. There's a lot of ways we grow, right? We grow in our faith with Jesus. We grow in understanding in our classes. You know, you grow every year, you learn a little more of math, a little more of grammar. And for some of us, that takes more than others. I'm not a grammar person, so I kind of get that. But every year, we grow a little bit more. And this year, we're going to pray for you and for your school year. And this year, my prayer is that you would follow Jesus' steps, that you would grow in wisdom and in stature, that you would have favor with your teachers, with your friends. And I'm going to pray something else today. I'm going to pray that God gives you the right relationships, that God gives you Christian mentors. Those are people that are a little bit older than you that can help you show you what it looks like to follow Jesus. I'm going to pray that God gives you people who are your peers, your friends, that can encourage your faith in Jesus. Because we don't just want to grow in our knowledge, we want to do that. We want to grow in our faith, we want to grow in our relationships. and especially our relationship with Jesus today. So this morning, let's pray for our children here today. And God, we just come before you. We thank you, Father, for how you've been faithful to us throughout this summer. We pray for our kids as they enter a new school year, that your blessing is upon them, Lord. We pray that the teaching of Luke 2:5-2 would be lived out in them, that they would grow in wisdom, in stature, in favor with you and with others around them. I pray, God, that you would give them Christian mentors in our children's ministry program, in other walks of their life, to help show them what it means to follow you. I pray, Father, that you would give them Christian friends that can encourage their faith in you. And for their friends who do not know you yet, that they would be a shining light of your love and grace. That they, through their lives and through their words, would encourage their friends to come to know you. I pray you protect these children and all of our children, Lord God, and all the schools they go to from any and all harm. That the schools be a place of peace and protection. Lord, physically, emotionally, mentally, in every way, God. And we pray, Jesus, that as they grow this year, they would grow their faith. They would grow to be more like you, to know you more, and to live a deeper relationship. We pray, God, even as they open up their backpacks every day, that it's a reminder that their church is praying for them, that you love them, and that, Lord, we're walking with them on this journey of their lives. We pray this all in the mighty name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Well, thank you, boys and girls, for joining us today. You can head out to the kids' aisle if you're going to participate this morning. And thank you. Have a great and blessed day in school year. This morning, in a few moments, we'll go into prayer. We'll also lift up our school here, South Jersey Christian Academy, SJCA. They'll be all in full swing this week. I got a chance to meet with the teachers this week and just pray with them. And I got to tell you, I can just sense just an excitement and an energy in that room. That we have some new teachers, we have some long-tenure teachers who are coming back, and there's just a sense that God's doing some great things. This is the school's highest enrollment ever this year. So, yeah. And so that means that more kids and families are going to get to hear about Jesus and be discipled through the school. And you know, Christian schools sometimes have different focuses. Some Christian schools are really just about Christians attending, and that's okay, that's a good thing. But one thing that our school is about is we're an outreach school. That we make space for kids who maybe don't know Jesus yet, for families who maybe they've not been able to make it in the public school system. And so we have families coming in who don't know Jesus. And wish we could share with you all the stories, but if you talk to Nancy and Robin, there's just so many accounts of people who come in. One story in particular, Nancy said, told me not too long ago, was this parent came to her one day and said, "Who is this Jesus that my child is coming home talking about?" Wow. Because they had Bible class, and they're talking about Jesus and reading from the scriptures, but their parent didn't know about Jesus. You know, we assume that in our world that everyone has an idea of who Jesus is. But just from that child being in the school, hearing the message of Jesus, going home and talking about it, it made this parent want to come and say, "Who is this Jesus?" And so I want to thank you as a congregation for the way you support SJCA, the way you pray for it, because it literally is a way in which we are proclaiming the gospel to our community and the surrounding communities. We met one family at the Ice Cream Social this week. They're driving from Deptford every day to bring their children here. That's the kind of hunger that is out there for with the ministry of SJCA. Yeah. Now, I didn't have this planned, so I'm just going to put people on the spot, and I'm going to ask for forgiveness rather than permission. I know Robin is with us today. If there's anyone else from South Jersey Christian Academy, any teachers or aides, would you just stand up for a minute? We're gonna go into a prayer time. I want to acknowledge you. So anyone else who's here today, do you help out at lunch or anything? So we're gonna pray. We're gonna include them in our prayer this morning, and As we go to prayer today, you may be seated. We're going to lift you back up in just a minute. As we go to prayer this morning, we're going to continue to pray for the Mage family. You see the flowers up here. We celebrated Ruth's life yesterday in a service of death and resurrection. And we highlighted all the ways in which God blessed her and blessed us through her, and the promise of resurrection life that we believe Ruth is experiencing as we speak. We know there are many others today who are recovering from surgeries, illnesses, and we just want to invite you to keep them in your prayers as we pray this morning as well. So let's go before God in prayer. And if you have an SJCA person around, you just stretch your hands towards them. We're going to pray for them today. Gracious God, this morning we thank you for the way you have sustained us throughout this year, throughout this summer, and as we are ready for a new fall season, as we pray for our kids, we want to lift up our teachers from SJCA, but also our teachers. We know we have teachers here that are teaching in public schools and in charter schools in different places. Each of them, God, has a special and unique ministry. And we thank you for the call you placed upon their lives. We pray first, God, for our SJCA school, Lord Jesus. We thank you for the staff put together. We pray your blessing upon Robin, the principal, upon Nancy, the business administrator, and upon all of the staff, God. Teachers, aides, volunteers. We just pray, God, that you watch over them throughout this year, that you would bless them, that you would enable them, God, to be filled with your Spirit, to lead not just the children, but their families closer to you. Would you protect them, God? Keep them and their families healthy and safe, and provide all that is needed for them, Lord. We pray for those who are teaching and serving in public school settings or charter school settings. God, we thank you for their witness of faith to you in these places. Would you watch over them? We know teachers have experienced great stress over these last few years. Would you refresh them? Give them a renewed vitality and energy for their profession and their call. And Lord, would they just know that they are where you have placed them, that they are there where you have sent them, and may they, in the ways they are able, Lord, be a light for you to their students, to their families, to the faculty. God, we thank you for the witness of faith that we celebrated yesterday with the homegoing service of Ruth Mage. Would you continue to comfort her family, friends, and loved ones? Lord, may they take comfort in the fact that Ruth knew you as her Lord and Savior. May they continue to follow you in the days ahead. For those, God, who continue to recover from surgery, from illnesses, from battling disease, God, we pray for your strength and blessing upon them. And Jesus, we pray today for our community. We pray your blessing upon Winslow Township in Sinclairville. We pray your blessing upon this nation. And Lord, upon the peoples of the earth, God. We recognize, Lord, that many times we go our own way rather than yours. And we ask that you forgive us today of those things. Would you reveal the ways in which we as a community or as a nation or Lord, just as humanity have turned from you? Would you help us to humble ourselves and pray and seek your face, God? And Lord, would we see you as the answer, not something we've contrived on our own? Today, Jesus, we pray that you help us as a church be on mission for you, that we keep pressing forward for the goal you've called us towards, heavenward in Christ Jesus. And we pray this all in the mighty name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Now, I did that a little bit out of order, so I'm going to revert back just a second. I got a little bit passionate today. We're going to do just a couple quick announcements, and I wanted just to invite you, if you're a guest or a regular attender, to fill out the pew pads. You can find those in your rows, and if you just do that, if you're a guest, we'll be sure to follow up with you this week, and if you're a regular attender, it just helps us to get an accurate record of attendance. Invite you to review your bulletin. There's a lot of good stuff coming up with the fall. Alive, our Wednesday night programming for families is going to begin on September the 21st. There will be opportunities for children and adults, and we're working on and praying through a new youth program. So please keep that in prayer. We're talking with some folks about that. And we also want to invite you this morning to prepare for giving the offering. We're at the giving station out in the lobby. You can also give digitally in ways that you can see inside of your bulletin. There's directions if you open your bulletin up. And as we think about the offering, one thing that struck me this week as I was reading the scripture is found in Deuteronomy 8. And in Deuteronomy 8, it's to the children of Israel, it's reminded them to not forget the Lord. And it says this, talking about when they would enter the promised land. It says, you may say to yourself, my power and the strength of my hands have produced this wealth for me. But remember the Lord your God, for it is he who gives you the ability to produce wealth, and so confirms his covenant, which he swore to your forefathers, as it is today. In essence, God was reminding Israel that they might come into a season of great blessing. And when they come to that season of great blessing, they may say, I've done it, and it's all about me. And God was reminding them that in those times, they need to say, you know what? It's the Lord who's given me the ability to do this. It's the Lord who has provided for me. And so when we give in the offering, it's a way in which we remember God. We remember God's blessings. We remember God's generosity towards us. So whether you're giving in person today or whether you're giving digitally, thank you for the way in which you give and support God's work here and around the world. This morning, we're going to continue in our time of singing, and we're going to share a hymn. This is from number 467 in the blue hymnals in your pew. It's called Trust and Obey. A great hymn that really sums up what it means to follow Jesus. We're trusting him. We're walking in obedience. So as you're able today, would you stand and join us as we bring our hearts and voices together.
Thank you.
may be seated. Our scripture reading this morning is from Paul's letter to the church in Philippi, Philippians chapter 3, verses 4 through 14. Let us hear the word of the Lord. If someone else thinks they have reasons to put confidence in the flesh, I have more. Circumcised on the eighth day of the people of Israel, the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews in regard to the law, a Pharisee, as for zeal persecuting the church, as for righteousness based on the law, faultless. But whatever were gains to me now, I now consider loss for the sake of Christ. What is more, I consider everything a loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord, for whose sake I have lost all things. I consider them garbage, that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ, a righteousness that comes from God on the basis of faith. I want to know Christ, yes, to know the power of his resurrection and participation in his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, and so somehow attaining to the resurrection from the dead. Not that I have already obtained all this, or have already arrived at my goal, but I press on, take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of me. Brothers and sisters, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it, but of one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining toward what is ahead, I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus. Lord God, today we thank you for your word. We pray and ask that you would open it up to our hearts and minds, illuminate it to us, Lord. Help us to hear and see beyond our understanding what you're calling us to hear and see. We pray, Jesus, we'd be encouraged as always transformed by your love and grace through this text. We pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. This morning, we're going to finish up our series called Back At It. And Eric, I misplaced my clicker. So can you show that first picture up there? This is a picture from an article I read last year from the Washington Post. And it is about a gentleman from the 1912 Japanese Olympic team. His name is Shizu Kanakori. And Mr. Kanakori was one of only two individuals Japan sent to the 1912 Games in Stockholm, Sweden. And his journey is a very unique one. Today, Olympic athletes usually have a very elaborate process for travel and getting there, and this kind of a very different experience. For Mr. Kanakori, he had to travel 17 days from Japan to Sweden, taking a boat and then a series of trains, traveling the length of the Trans-Siberian Railway. Now, if you're a professional athlete preparing to face the world's best professional athletes at the Olympics, a 17-day travel time where you're sitting for hours on end is not the best way to prepare. He would get off at train stations, and when the train was parked for a few minutes, go on the platform there, run in place, try and do some wind sprints just to keep himself kind of going and in shape to some degree. But by the time he arrived in Sweden, he was understandably exhausted. He was having trouble adjusting to a new food diet. You know, they didn't have, you know, a lot of times now there's a whole diet that Olympians will use, and their team will be able to provide for them the whole way through. This was a whole different diet for him. And by the time he got to the day of the marathon, he was just exhausted, tired, his body was not at its peak. When he began to run, it was a blisteringly hot day in the 90s, to the point where almost half of the runners who began the marathon that day did not finish. They just were worn out. And Mr. Kanakori was one who was with them. About halfway through the race, he passed out. And there were some local folks who lived in that area, and they saw what had happened. They actually took him in and kind of nursed him back to some level of health. He kind of was revived a little bit, but he was embarrassed that he didn't finish the race. And so instead of going to the Olympic officials and telling them what was going on, and then just kind of going back to the rest of the games, he quietly left and made his way back to Japan. On the official documentation of the Swedish government, for 50 years, he was listed as a missing person. And then somehow in the 60s, they came to recognize that he actually was still alive. He was found, he was back in Japan. He He got married, he had kids, grandkids. And so someone had the idea in the Swedish government, let's invite him back to finish the race. And so in 1967, they reached out to him. And he said, I will come back and finish the race. His trip this time was a little bit faster, a little more direct. And he went back and finished the race. When he finished, his marathon time was 54 years, 8 months, 6 days, 5 hours, 32 minutes, and 20.3 seconds. When asked about his finish time, his statement was this. It was a long trip. Along the way, I got married, had 6 children and 10 grandchildren. But he finished the race. And when you're embracing or beginning a race, that's really the ultimate goal, is you want to finish. And when we receive Christ as our Savior, we begin that race of faith. It's a great beginning, but it's not just about beginning. It's about finishing the race. And in Philippians chapter 3 here, the verse that we read, Paul is kind of talking about this picture of continuing to press on in our faith in Jesus. Not to get caught in stopping, but to continue to move forward. And sometimes in our life of faith, we find ourselves maybe taking a little detour like Mr. Kanakori. Maybe we started a race, but maybe because of some circumstances that occurred, maybe because of some decisions we made, we found ourselves stopping. And maybe we're sitting here today, and as much as we'd like to be, get back at it, we kind of feel guilty about stopping. We feel bad about how much time we've lost. And yet, Mr. Kanakori's story reminds us that there's always time. We can get back at it. We can jump back in the race and continue to follow Christ. For some of us today, maybe we've been around church. We've been in a church for a long time, but we've never actually made a commitment to Jesus Christ. And today is a day when we are challenged to make that commitment and receive Christ and begin that race in earnest. Wherever you might find yourself today, maybe you're someone who is running the race. You're continuing to be faithful. Today, Paul's words will encourage us to continue to press on. So wherever you find yourself today, I want to invite us as we enter a new fall season, a new season here in Sicklerville, to say, God, how are you inviting me either to stay at it or to get back at it? How are you inviting me to go all in with you this coming year? And as Paul shares these verses, he's going to talk about his past, his present, and his future. We'll begin with his past. This is what he says. He talks about, if someone else thinks they have reasons to put confidence in the flesh, I have more. Now, Paul here is doing a little bit of boasting. He's basically saying, if anyone has a good resume, it's me. It's this guy. All right? And he's talking specifically within a Jewish context at that time, and specifically within a religious Jewish context. He lays things out like circumcised on the eighth day of the people of Israel, which was a requirement as part of their covenant relationship with God, of the tribe of Benjamin. He's identifying a tribe. Now, Benjamin, the Benjamin tribe, was a tribe in which the first king of Israel, Saul, came from. So that would have been a level of kind of prestigiousness. And Paul was originally named Saul after the first king of Israel. And so he's laying out more of his resume. Hebrew of Hebrews, in regard to the law, a Pharisee. He's accomplished and become a prominent Pharisee. He studied under Gamaliel, which was one of the most prominent teachers, rabbis of that time. For zeal persecuted the church, as for righteousness based on the law faultless. Before Christ, Paul lived a life in which his righteousness was all based on his adherence to keeping the law. It was about him. It was about what he could do. And he's kind of saying, I did it better than most people. But there's a but. But whatever pertains to me, I now consider loss for the sake of Christ. And so, while he had this great resume in his past, while in his Jewish religious establishment, he had a resume that was really hard to beat, he's saying when he encountered Jesus, things changed. And now as he looks back at all that other stuff, he considers it all loss compared to knowing Jesus. See, Paul came to a point in his life when he realized the goal he had been living for, or if you will, the race he had been running, was the wrong race. And if you've ever invested time, talent, or treasure in doing something in your life, and you found out that it was the wrong direction, you found out that it didn't fulfill the desires you wanted, it didn't meet the goal you were shooting for, it can be very discouraging. Let me give you a small example. When I was finishing seminary, you know, you kind of, there are certain classes you have to take, and then you can kind of align those classes, you choose them every semester. And in my last, really, semester there, I got to choose one class. It was my favorite teacher, my favorite professor. It was on the Book of Psalms. It's a great book to study. And so I was excited. This is a great way to kind of wrap it up. I made it through Hebrew and Greek and all kinds of different challenges. And I was finishing up with one class to focus on. Layup. Get down to the last assignment. I'm about to turn it in. About to click on submit. And it occurs to me that the professor has chosen certain psalms in which to complete this last assignment. And for whatever reason, I have chosen a different psalm than among the ones listed. So I have done a psalm he has not assigned. And if you've ever had that experience, it's as if your heart just falls through the ground. Because you spent years preparing and worked on this, and now you've spent the last 18 weeks working through this class, and you've done all this work on this assignment, and you realize you did the wrong assignment. It's pretty disheartening. Now, thankfully, my professor had a lot of grace. He's like, as long as you follow the rubric, even though it's a different psalm, that's okay. But sometimes in life, we find ourselves having worked for something, having put time and attention into something, and we realize, this is not what I expected. I've been running the wrong race. I've been shooting for the wrong goal. I've been taking the wrong path. And that may look different in different seasons. It could be we've lived for the pursuit of comfort and enjoyment over pursuing Christ. It could be that we've lived for more the gaining of more stuff or more wealth over what it means to follow Jesus. It could mean making ourselves the center of our orbit or universe rather than Jesus. Whatever that might look like, there's a lot of ways in which we can run the wrong race in life. And yet Paul is saying he realized that he has done that and he has recalibrated when he met Jesus. And so one of the questions I have for us today is, what race are we running? Are we running the race that leads us to Jesus? Are we running the race in which we can say we are pressing on and to get closer to him? Or have we found that our pursuit of other things, or even just of making ourselves the center of our lives, has come up empty? Paul doesn't talk about his present. And he says here that, what is more, I consider everything a loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord, for whose sake I have lost all things. And he skips down a few more verses, and he says, to be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ. See, Paul has made a really big transition here. He now sees the things in his past as a loss compared to knowing Jesus. His life is about knowing Jesus now. His life is about pursuing Christ. And he's one of the big transitions he has made is that in his previous season of life, in his past, the righteousness of his life was based upon him, his faithfulness to keeping a list of rules, keeping the covenant. But now his righteousness is based on Jesus and on who Jesus is and what Jesus has done and on Paul's willingness to receive that by faith, to receive Jesus by faith. He realized that he could only do so much. No matter how great his resume was, no matter how many things he accomplished, he was never going to be good enough. He was never going to do enough. He was never going to check enough boxes to please God because he couldn't do it on his own. Only Jesus could do that. And the beauty of Jesus is, while Jesus knew he was the only one who could do that, he made a way for us to be made righteous in our sinfulness. That as we place our faith in him and in his sacrifice, his resurrection, we are made righteous in God's sight because of Christ's sacrifice. We can be made new, and we can begin this race to follow Jesus. And for those of us today who maybe we've been around church for a long time and we've never made a commitment to Christ, that's the invitation, is that it is not about our report card and how we have done. It is about what Jesus has done and receiving that and then choosing every day of our life to continue to run that race, to continue to press in and to consider our past, all those things, as loss compared to knowing Christ. Dr. Stephen Fowle makes a really powerful statement about Paul's transition here. He says this: Paul subtly shifts from being the subject of his own story to being part of a story in which Christ is now the subject. And that's really one of the great transitions we have to make in our life of faith, is that it isn't about us. We are not the main character. I don't know if you've ever done that. You ever think of yourself as like the main character in the story? The main character is Jesus. And part of a life of discipleship, of becoming more like Christ, is realizing that Jesus is the main character. He is the one that it's all about. And he invites us into his story. And we find our identities, we find our meaning, we find our purpose, we find what it means to live a fulfilling and abundant life when we recognize the proper posture, that Jesus is the center. And when he is the center, all of a sudden, the rest of life begins to become a little bit clearer. So Paul goes on to talk about his future, and he says this: not that I have already obtained all this or already arrived at my goal, but I press on to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of me. Now here's Paul. He's not done yet. He's been a missionary, traveled to different parts of the world at that time, planting churches, telling people about Jesus. He's been persecuted, beaten, gone through all kinds of different trials. He's writing letters that eventually become scripture. And he says, I haven't arrived yet. I'm not there yet. God isn't done with me yet. He says, I'm pressing on to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of me. And that really is about being faithful to Christ to our last breath. Being faithful to that time where Jesus brings us to be with himself and we can receive the reward he has given us because of what he has done. It's about living a life where we don't take a stop that we never get back on the track. About living a life where we say, as long as God has given me breath, God has more for me to do. God has more for me to know and be in relationship with him. I think of a woman in one of my previous churches, Janet. And Janet was a faithful Christian throughout many years of her life. Served God in many different ways in the community, in the church. But as she got older, you know, sometimes the spirit is willing, but the body doesn't always cooperate, you know what I'm saying? And she wasn't able to do as much as she once did. But one of the things I admired so much about Janet is while maybe her ability to serve in different ways and do some of the things she used to wasn't there anymore, she always looked for ways in which she could continue to press on in her faith. Always looked for ways in which she could continue to allow God to use her. So even though she couldn't get out as much as she once did, she would pray for the church, sometimes by name, person by person, go through the prayer list. She would send cards to people, praying, letting them know she was praying for them and encouraging them. It was what she could do in that season of her life. But she saw her faith in Christ as an ongoing race to continue to press forward and to continue to allow God to use her. And while that may look differently as different seasons of life came at her, her goal was to continue to allow Jesus to use her in her life. See, sometimes we get this idea that we pursue Christ, but we can kind of check out, and we can kind of put it on cruise control. And yet the scriptures and Paul are saying, no. Keep pressing on. Keep pushing in. Keep seeking more of Jesus. Keep allowing God to use you more and more until that day when we meet him face to face. That may look differently when you're in your 30s. It may look differently when you're in 40s, 50s, 60s, 70s, whatever that may be, whatever season we're in. It may look differently when we're going through a season where we've just gone through a lot. We've had some loss in our life. It may look different when we're battling health issues. But we can always keep pressing into Jesus. We can always say, God, how in this season of my life can I allow you to use me to bless you and others? So I want to ask this a question as we go into this fall season. Are you all in? Are you all in with Jesus? That's a theme for South Jersey Christian Academy this year, all in with God. And I want to ask that question for us as a church. We have a great history here at Sucreville. God has been so faithful to us. And so many of you who are here have been a part of that, have sacrificed, have given, have served. But I don't believe God is done with us. I believe God has a future and a plan and a purpose for us. But it's going to take all of us saying, I'm all in. And that's going to look different for each of us. That's going to look different for how we live that out. But as we as a church, can we say, God, whatever that looks for me and my family, I'm willing to hear your call and say, I am all in with you. Let me give you a close with this example. A picture here of a pool. Now, a lot of us love pools, love being around pools. But I've come to believe there are three different types of pool people. I want you to think about where you are today. Some of us are the cannonball pools. You know, you see the pool from a distance, and you see this a lot in young children. We start running from 100 yards away and get as much speed as possible, and we jump in and create as much splash as possible, which is the reason why they make adult swim times. So you just want to go all in and splash as many people as possible as they go all in. And then there are the waste waders. That's those of us who we still like being in the pool, but only up to a certain level, because there's, when you're up to your waist, it's kind of comfortable. When you start to get up to like your chest, it's a little more uncomfortable. And then there are the sunbathers. We love being around the pool. We love being around the atmosphere of the pool and the noise of kids playing and all that. But we just want to really soak in the sun. We don't want to get wet. Now, that may be how you may address the pool in different ways, but I want to take that metaphor and use that in our faith. Because are we a cannonballer for Jesus? Are we willing to go all in with him? Every part of us, and say, Jesus, I'm all in. Or are we a waste waiter? We say, Jesus, I'm comfortable with you being up to here a certain level. But there are certain parts of me I just want to hold back. I've done my time. I've given what I need to give for you. I'm just going to hold something back. Or are we a sunbather? We say, Jesus, I love being around the church. I love being around you and people who are following you. But if I'm real honest, I don't really want to get in. Friends, today, the call of the scriptures is to go all in and stay all in with Jesus. Some of us may be like Mr. Kamikori, and for whatever reason, we've taken a little detour. Today, Jesus is inviting us to come back. He's saying, you can still finish the race. There's still time. Some of us may be weary, and that's okay. Lord, in my season of life, how might you call me to be all in? What does that look like for me? Today, as we receive communion, it's a time to respond to God's call and invitation and say, Lord, as you search my heart, how are you calling me to go all in with you today? I'm going to invite up Pastor True to come forward. He's going to assist me today as we prepare, and Gina's wife will come and be one of our attendants. This morning, I'm going to give you an invitation. You need to be a member of this or any church to come and receive. If you're seeking to follow Jesus Christ, you're invited to come and receive communion this morning. Today, as we begin, I'm going to invite us into a few moments of quiet prayer. Dave's going to play for us, and this is a time for confession. It's a time where we join the psalmist and say, search our hearts, God. Show us if there is a sin we need to confess. Show us if there is a behavior we need to address. And as God reveals those things to you, just confess them to the Lord. He already knows, and he loves us still. And as you confess them, know that God forgives us. And like Paul, forget what is behind. Leave those things in the past. Know that Christ's grace is enough. And so I invite you to spend a few moments of quiet prayer as Dave plays, and I'll bring us back in just a few moments to consecrate communion this morning. Thank you. you are forgiven. God proves his love for us, that he died for us. Today, I pray that you receive God's grace and forgiveness. Amen.
Will you hear these familiar words? Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right that we should always and everywhere give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who rose victoriously from the dead and comforts us with the blessed hope of everlasting life. And so, with all the people of earth and all the company of heaven, we can praise your name and join that everlasting hymn, saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, we give birth to your church. Deliver us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. When the Lord Jesus Christ ascended, he promised to be with us always in the power of your word and the Holy Spirit.
On the night in which Christ gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks, blessed it, and gave it to his disciples, and said, This is my body, which is given for you. Take, eat, do this in remembrance of me. When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks, blessed it, gave it to his disciples, and said, This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. So, gracious God, today we thank you for all your mighty works of salvation and grace. We thank you for the bread and the juice here. And we pray, God, that you pour out your Holy Spirit on this community of faith gathered today, on these gifts of bread and juice. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until that day when you come in victory, and we feast around your table at your heavenly banquet. In the name of Jesus Christ, our risen Savior and coming Lord. Amen. This morning, I'm going to invite our ushers to come up at this time. As they come up, Drew and Jean are going to give them the trays, and then the usher will serve us right there in our pews. As they come around, the ushers are going to have two different trays. The gold tray is going to have the all-in-one communion cups we've been using, and there are going to be the kind of the regular communion. And then the baskets will have gluten-free options. So as they come around, each usher will have both. If you need a certain option, just choose that. You can take that from the basket or the tray. We invite you just to hold your communion cup until all have received, and then we'll receive together. As the ushers passes out, just invite you to be in a time of prayer.
Thank you.
threatened to invite you to take out the weight room. This is the body of Christ given for you. I invite you to receive it, eat it, and receive it with thanksgiving in your heart. Now I invite you to open up the juice. This is the blood of Christ, which has been shed for you. The blood that washes away every sin and every stain. So as we receive this day, you be like Paul, forgetting what has been behind, forgetting all those things, allowing the blood of Jesus to wash them away. You can move forward into a new life with Christ. I invite you to receive it now, thanksgiving in your heart. And now I'd like to just close us. If you know the Lord's Prayer, I'd invite you to join me in saying this prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Thank you so much for joining us today. Have a wonderful and blessed week. We look forward to worshiping you again next Sunday.
Probably not for the next one.